All right, if there's one tree that somebody told me you are only allowed one tree to look for your morels, where would it be? It would always be near slippery elm trees. Follow me in this video. I'm going to show you the difference between the slippery elm and the American elm. There's two elms here in west central Pennsylvania where I'm currently videotaping. It is the middle of April. We're going to go over tree identification because in my opinion that the slippery elm outproduces not only with quantity but also with quality. I find more quality morels by slippery elms. Right now it's the middle of April. Things are just starting to green up and there's two trees that turn green right off the bat, and that's the elms and the tulip poplars. The tulip poplars are also good trees to look for morels by, but in this video, we're going to focus strictly on elms. So basically, driving down the road, constantly looking for when those trees first start to turn green. You may not see anything, but all of a sudden, if you see one tree pop out that's bright green, you know, maybe want to go check it out, see if it's an elm tree or a poplar, tulip poplar, and mark it. Keep it in your GPS or in your notebook to where that tree's at. But right here is a slippery elm tree, and there's actually three of them. One, two, three, or four, I guess you could say. And if you notice, right when they start coming out, you'll see these seed pods, and they'll look like little balls on the twigs. And when you're driving down the road, these stick out really, really well against the like a cloudy sky, and you can see it just looks little balls on the twigs, and those seed pods are a good indication of an elm tree, and you'll want to mark those elm trees. And now the elm tree has Dutch elms disease, which the trees don't live that long; they die quick, and it's usually the dead and dying trees that you want to find morels by. This tree has produced morels almost every year for the past 5 years for me. Now granted, on this side it looks really rigid and it's not even as deep as my fingers, so it's not real deep. It's more of a flat ridge, very flat. You can see it kind of comes out on this side, but we come around here, this is going to be the more typical of what you're going to see, and this can look like a lot of other trees. People will get this confused with sometimes tulips. They can get it confused with locusts. They can also get it confused with white ash. Just kind of notice that the bark doesn't have thick ridges. It's not real thick. It's not very deep down in there. I mean, not even the length of my fingernail down in. But you can kind of see how it goes up so far. You can see how this ridge goes the whole way. And then you'll see little gaps, and it'll come back down. And then you'll have longer ones again. And then you'll have shorter ones that are only little gaps right here. So those are some things that you want to look at the bark. Just really pay attention to that bark. And compare this with the American elm. And you're going to see that the American elm has really thicker bark. Another thing is you can kind of see how the bases, there's some bases. It doesn't come straight down. It has some, arms, I guess you could say, that come out on both sides. Here you can see on this one too, it does that over here. So there again, you can see how once they go up so far, you can kind of see how they branch off up there. They can be quite tall, and they will sort of drop down. You can kind of see how this branch right here is coming down. One of my favorite ways to find trees is just driving down the road and look behind me. A massive American elm tree. So let's go check out the American elm tree and compare it with the slippery elm. Right now, since we are in the middle of April, towards the end of April, that they come out with these little seed pods. We look really closely at them. They are really, really fuzzy. When you look up in the sky, just like all elms, they just look like they have little tiny balls all over the twigs. When we start looking around and looking at all the other trees that are around the area, there's hardly anything that's green other than bushes. Nothing else around here is turning green unless it's a tulip poplar or an elm tree. they droop. So once they come out, you can see how they'll droop down. And this one here, they'll droop down. And they're coming out, and then they droop down again. So that's another distinguishing feature. We can see what those, look at those real fine little fuzzy discs. And that's what you want to look for. When these will fall on the ground, they'll be all over the place. It'll be easy to see. There's what the seed pods look like. These have just sprouted within the past week. We noticed the bark is relatively different. We still see the ridges, but look at how thick those ridges are. It literally almost makes my finger disappear from how thick those ridges are. And they're not too flat, but it's very gnarly. It's I guess you could say more of a barkier bark, scaly sort of. The furrows are deeper. Now granted, this is a really, really big tree, so usually the big, big, big trees will have real thick bark. Then you can see the flares from the base come out like that. That's very distinct of elm trees. When we look up here towards the limbs, you can kind of see how the bark isn't as thick, but still, it's a little bit different than the slippery elm. Now, if we notice, this tree is right in a little swamp. There's a ditch that comes out right here by the road, and it comes right down here. So these trees love springs, wet areas, not necessarily swamps, but places that have very, very moist soil. Now this is probably the biggest American elm tree I know of around. This thing is huge. This is how you can tell a slippery elm from an American elm, is by having one of these. Now since I'm in Pennsylvania, I have a Pennsylvania tree book. If you're not in Pennsylvania, or maybe let's say you're in New York, or let's say you're down south, I'm in the Northeast, so I'm going to look for books that are Pennsylvania or Northeast trees. If you're down south, say in Georgia or, you know, Tennessee, you're going to look for books that are, you know, Southeast United States, or specific to the state that you're in, because the majority of morel hunting is looking for the right trees and being able to distinguish even within the tree species one from another, because that's where you're going to be driving down the road. You don't want to be doing your scouting for morels during the season. You want to be doing it outside of the season. Just like a good deer hunter or anybody else, you prepare year round. You're scouting 24/7. No matter if it's in the middle of winter and you're, let's say, half hour from home, what are you going to be doing? I'm driving around and I'm looking at bark, and I'm being able to tell the difference between an American elm and a slippery elm just by the bark, without looking at leaves or seeds or anything like that, because I will keep a mental note of that. And then when the season comes and people start finding morels, then all I do is I go back and I start researching all those places that I wrote down of good places, whether they be big giant trees or really good stands of elm trees. It's not necessarily just because you find a slippery elm you're gonna find morels, but it's more or less the numbers, by the numbers. The same way with apple orchards. You can go over 100 apple trees till you find morels. It's about putting the numbers in. So finding very, very good stands of the trees that you're looking for to put your time in morel hunt. Here, just driving around, come into town, and you can see the river right here beside the road. And I just want to show you a smaller, an American elm tree. Now this one here is a bunch of little trees that grew close by and kind of grew together. But notice the bark. A lot different from that big, big, big giant tree. So this is why we need to look at multiple trees, even within the same species, because bigger trees and younger trees, the bark changes as they grow older. But notice that bark. We don't have the really deep dip, the really deep, deep furrows compared to the big old tree, but we still have deeper furrows, or I guess you could say more distinct furrows than the slippery elm. Also, it's a little bit more ragged, I guess you could say, a little bit more thicker. It's not as smooth or as flat. Now these are flat on the sides. We can see that on the side right here. They are flat. They're not rounded, but a little bit, I guess you could say, a little crackly, a little bit. Now, here we can look on this one here. Just kind of looking at this and making mental notes. It's really hard to describe bark. That's another thing. To try to put descriptions on bark, everyone's gonna have their own little description of what it looks like. And so when we're looking up through the tree, just like driving down this road, we can look up and we can see the distinct features of those seed pods. And here, let's look at these trees. These are not elm trees. These are locusts. And these ones have extremely deep furrows. Put almost my whole hand in one of those furrows. Very distinct, very thick and rigid. There's not quite flat on the top, but we notice there's nothing green. And look how green that elm tree is. The whole reason why we're going over the American elm is just so that we can make sure we're distinguishing that from a slippery elm. All right, now here's another tree, the tulip poplar. I've already mentioned it several times, but we're gonna take a closer look at its bark also, because we need to be able to identify these, whether we're driving down the road in the car, driving 40, 50 miles an hour. You need to be able to identify trees in a split second driving down the road. At least that's what I try to do, because I want to know what those trees are the second I look at them. I don't want to have to think about it. We see a more tighter pattern. We do see flat ridges, but the part of it is they have these little tiny lines that constantly go through. So it kind of looks crackled and broke up. It's very, very smooth. We can see as we come around the tree, it doesn't stick out. It's very straight up and down. It feels smooth, but we see lots of ridges. This is different than the slippery elm because we don't see a flat, thin pieces of bark. It's more of a chunky pieces of bark. As you can see right here, it's sort of squared off. It goes down at a 90 degree angle and it's thick, whereas the slippery elm has more of a flat, peeled off type of bark, almost like when you picture shag bark hickory, how those long strands of bark kind of peel off. Just imagine those being really flat on the bark. That's what's going to separate slippery elm from tulip trees. Again, lots of people find lots of morels by tulip poplar, but today we're mostly focusing on the slippery elm. All right, back to the slippery elm. We're going to look at some more distinct features and just some things that you notice. A lot of slippery elm seem to grow on banks. They really like banks, and I think it really is the reason, because they like that well-drained soil. You'll see them near streams, springs, close to water, but they're not going to be in the water. They're not going to be right next to the water. They're going to be on a place where the water's close, but the water can drain off real quick. So if you notice right here, look at the bank that I'm on. And it goes right down into this flat. And this tree is growing right here. And look at this tree. Now, we already see signs of decay. Some of this bark, we see bugs are drilling holes in it. Now, look at that bark. It just looks a little different than what we traditionally think of slippery elm. You usually don't see these little gnarly stuff coming out here. And usually, the tree's usually round. But here we got a little flare, like branch coming off the side of the tree. But as we go up, the bark begins to look a little bit more closely like what we do. We see the difference between that and tulip in that it looks a little bit more flakier, a little bit more distinct in the furrows that go up through there, the ridges. And again, when we look up, we just see those seed pods. They are just so noticeable. Found a low-hanging young branch. Look how vivid and bright those things are. You're really going to be able to spot those a really long ways. They're more of a light green, but they're very visible from a long ways away. And when we notice these ones compared to the American elm, they're not real fuzzy compared to the American elm. So we look at they do have a little fuzzy in the middle. Around the seeds, but as you can see how those little clumps, and these will all fall individually and they will just litter the floor around the slippery elm. So there's the type of seed pod that you want to be looking for. Now right here is a smaller elm tree, and you can see all the bigger it is and how that bark, you can see that it's not very distinct. It's just as they grow older, these ridges are going to be, notice how compared to that tulip poplar, we have little flakes coming off. And you can kind of see back behind the pieces of bark like that, where you're not going to have that with tulip poplar. Found some morels already. First ones of the 2019 season. Right there. If you notice again, look at where it's at. It's on the edge of a steep hill. Look at the bark falling off of the elm tree right there. This tree is 100% dead, this elm tree, and the elm trees around it, they're a little bit alive. They have some seed pods yet. You can see the elm tree right there, bark falling off. Typical textbook spot. I got a couple other trees to check. Let's go check them now. So now here's another valuable lesson. Yeah, you're already looking, spying this tree right here behind me with the bark falling off. But you're gonna find lots of trees that you're not gonna find any morels by. But that doesn't mean to write off those trees. If they're still holding the bark, you keep them in your records. This tree here, and look again, how far away from the tree, within where the bark has fallen off. There's two. Here's another one right beside my backpack here. Right there. So there's three. Oh, there we got another one right there. So there's four. So as you see here, right there's the tree where all the morels are growing by. And right here's another tree, a rather good sized one, two of them growing side by side. And there's no bark missing, but there's no seed pods, which means the tree is completely dead. And we see that the grapevines have pretty much killed this tree. And we see one branch that probably broke from wind damage, bark falling off. But we're mainly looking at the main tree trunk. The bark hasn't fallen off yet. And I've already looked around. I have not seen any morels. But that tree right there that has the bark starting to come off, that's the one that has the morels all by it. Okay, the last look-alike tree for the slippery elm tree is the white ash. And if you look, that bark at first glance looks just like a slippery elm. It's light in color. It's kind of flat on the top when it's smooth. You can see here how smooth it is. But then over here, we see how pointy it is. We can peel some of this off and we can see that it's not flat on top. It comes to a point. And here's one thing with the white ash is they're all dead too. The emerald ash borer beetle basically wiped out the white ash. So there's a lot of dead and dying white ash out there, and you see that bark cop coming off the tree and you're like, yes. And you get up there and it's white ash. That doesn't mean that you might not find morels by it. Some people specifically hunt for white ash. Some parts of the country, that's what people look for. But I haven't really seen morels by white ash here in my part of Pennsylvania. So, but that doesn't mean to write off this tree. Look for this tree also. Here we can kind of see the weaving pattern of the bark when it gets older. You know, when I'm driving down the road, this is the tree I have to take a second look at, because this one fools me more times than any other tree is the white ash. The leaves are starting to come out on the slippery elms and the American elms. Can still find morels right now, but the season is winding to an end, only because we got a little bit of an early start this year to the morel season. Let's take a closer look at these leaves. So as we can see, here's how one of the branches look. And we can see that they are alternate as they come up off the branch. Let's just take this little twig here off. And we can notice those. We can see how they come to a little bit of a point. To the feel, the leaf feels very, very rough. You can see how the edges of the leaves are serrated. It comes to a very fine point. They're near the end. So there is a slippery elm leaf. And you can see how the whole leaf structure on the tree is. That's the way they will look like. And right here is that tree. And if we notice, we can look up there and we can see them seed pods. There's still a lot of seed pods still on there, but if we notice, the leaves are also starting to come out. They will darken with age, but right now, this is what we're looking for. And we can see, oh, again, them seed pods up there. All right, we've got an American elm tree here. Let's check out the leaf pattern on this tree. Well, there we can see the pattern and the leaf structure of the American elm tree, and we can tell with those seed pods, just like the slippery elm, looks very, very identical. When we look closer at the leaf feels a little bit smoother compared to the slippery elm. And we can see how, just on the other alternate, coming out on the stems, we can see where the seed pods were here. But yeah, also serrated on the edges, comes to a point, just like the slippery elm, and the leaves may not get as dark when they get older, but very, very similar in leaves when you're looking at the American elm and the slippery elm. Again, when we look at the tree, we could see how big this tree is. They get so much bigger than the slippery elms. All right, hopefully you guys enjoyed this video. As you can see, the difference between the American elm and the slippery elm, you know, just some things we noticed, that the leaf pattern is very similar, the seed pods are very similar, the bark has a little bit of a difference, but the overall tree look and appearance is very much the same. The American elm itself is a longer lived tree. It gets bigger and it gets taller compared to the slippery elm. I like to focus more on slippery elm when I'm looking for morels. If you guys want to watch this year's morel hunting video, stay tuned. I'm going to put a link at the end of the video. Be sure to subscribe and like below, share this video. Hope you guys enjoyed it. More to come.